Welcome to 100 Days of Horror, rule number 8, Feast 2, Sloppy Seconds, directed by John Gulliker, who also directed the other two films in the series, and Piranha 3DD, another film that's been sitting on my unwatched movie shelf that I'll probably get to later on in this series, which I've heard is pretty awful, so we'll see how that goes. So I expect it'll show up later on this project. It was written by Patrick Melton and Marcus Dunstan, a pair who wrote all three of these films, the underrated collector films, and a few of the later Saw movies, which kind of get here or there, depending on which ones you look at. The first Feast was notable as being the only successful film to come out of Ben Affleck and Matt Damon's HBO series Project Greenlight, and these went on their own way after that. For one more, after this, instead, there's three. The first Feast was a blast for fans of the genre, playing with tropes, cliches, expectations across its story of primordial creatures besieging a collection of people in a bar. Akin to Assault on Precinct 13 or Rio Bravo, which, you know, essentially is a remake of there. The best part is the character title card spelling out the expectations and the general name of hero, you know, stone guy, which Jason Mewes first time around. And there, you know, the little bit of their backstory, a couple jokes, and their expected survival time. And so what they did there is they played with those and moved them around and got us in surprising ways. It's a horror film made by horror fans for horror fans. The first Feast was over the top, gross, gory, and wonderfully perverted in sense of humor, if you're into that sense of humor, which I know I often sometimes am. Depends on how you do it. You gotta do it right. Otherwise, it just comes off as cheap. Feast 2 is nearly as entertaining, picking up the next day with survivors hobbling out to find the neighborhood town to be completely under siege by even more monsters. It does what many good sequels do. It completely ups the ante in everything that worked in the first one. It's bloodier, it's gorier, there's more monsters. Yeah, it's a lot more fun in that way. You know, and even jumps up the humor in its childishness, which sometimes works, it sometimes doesn't, because they're not trying as hard to be, yeah, to be clever in their childishness. More of like, you know, here's a nut joke, here's a dick joke, without actually trying to make anything else come out of it. You know, what's impressive is now in full daylight for most of the movie, so the monsters, which you see fleetingly the first time in the dark, they look really cool seeing them in the daytime, which shows how well they're designed. And so big props designed for the sequel for Optic Nerve Studios. Seeing them full light, so many more of them, it could have come off really cheap, could have come off like masks in the later Planet of the Apes movies, where they obviously just put a mask on somebody and put it in the back. No, they all look cool, and they all look great. The downside for this time is that the characters aren't as interesting, so we already kind of used up the tropes the first time around. So they kind of exhausted there, so now we just get almost like the next level down from these B-movie characters. The first one, so we get C levels. And then moving to the town to a singular location, we get it kind of repetitive with their hold up. They start to argue, because otherwise we wouldn't have, you know, drama. They get attacked, some people die, we get some blood, we get some guts. They all run away, they meet some new interesting characters to replace the ones that died, and then they hole up, they argue with the new characters, they get attacked. So that kind of gets repetitive in many ways, but the character interactions are interesting enough, and they're funny enough, and then of course, the movie's like, what, 85 minutes long, so it's super short in order to get as much blood and guts as we can in there. So for what it is, it's a lot of fun, it's a blast. If you like the first movie, you like this one just as much. And from what I heard from Tony, that who I talked about in other ones, he says Feast 3 is just the same. So if that's what you're into, that's what you're into, that's what you love. So for what it is, I'll completely give it a solid B. You know, it's a completely subjective there, because, you know, this is not a B to everybody else, but it is to me, because if it's what you want, that's what you want. So yeah, I'll give it that, a subjective B. And, surprise second, sequel review. So, a sequel to a sequel. Of course, it's not a surprise if you read the title. I'm sure you did, fellow geeks. Title right down there, next to that subscribe button, which I should have mentioned earlier. This time we have Stakeland 2, The Stakelander, which, despite the silly title of The Stakelander, is actually a much different movie than Feast 2, which I'll talk about that there in a second. This was actually a movie that I mentioned a couple weeks ago, because I pulled it out of this last month's horror block, which actually, sad to say, what I heard might be the last. Apparently Nerd Block is folding. They say they're coming back as something bigger and better, maybe consolidating a few things, but until I have one in my hands, which probably, you know, it's it's August, so I'll get August month in November. I'll worry about that in November, right? Hopefully I'll be opening one for you guys soon. We have review number 9, Stakeland 2. 2000 Stakeland is a film which I know I saw, and my feeling was that it was a solid flick. I should have tried to revisit it before embarking on rewatching this one, watching this one for the first time, but I didn't have the time to get to it because I got so many of these to watch along with work and school and other movies and, you know, watching Annabelle yesterday and all sorts of fun. But my fleeting memories did have enough to bring me up to speed for this really solid as well sequel. It really helps having very much underappreciated horror stalwart Larry Fessenden producing. Who doesn't love Larry Fessenden? I know you do, Jen, if you're watching this. The first Stakeland was co-written by Dick DiBicci and the director Jim Minkle. It's a road trip vampire movie in which DiBicci, playing a mysterious man known only as Mister, is helping boy Martin get to Canada for a New Eden during the middle of a zombie apocalypse. So this one picks up 10 years later, and as I mentioned earlier, it's not the absolutely fun, over-the-top gore that's Feast. This is a much more somber, serious movie. It's actually, coming out this year, it's the next in the series of revisionist westerns, like Logan's, not nearly as good as Logan, of course, but of taking western concepts and putting it into different genres as Logan did. So we have this one, it picked up 10 years later, it's still written by DiBicci, and this time the directors have been replaced with Dan Burke and Robert Olson. I'm not sure what else they've done, but after New Eden is destroyed, Martin is again alone, and he goes out to seek out Mister to try and get his help in getting revenge upon this vampire queen. Who killed his wife and his child. Sorry, spoilers. It's the first 5 minutes of the movie. And so unfortunately, the last movie, while ending on an upper note, does not continue into this one. So we're 10 years after the vampire plague has destroyed humanity, so we don't have as many vampires running around. Instead, as we often have in post-apocalyptic movies, or even right after zombie apocalypse, like in Dawn of the Dead, we have the humans are worse than the vampires, who are kind of easily defeated, and they look great. They get great effects. One of the things I love about the first movie that I remember, and of course about this one, is how great the vampires look. It's a slightly different design than we're used to, and it's distinctive that you can look at, say, that Stakeland's vampires. So the world building is really cool in there. It's often what we have seen in other movies, where you get little enclaves of these people here, we get cannibals here, but then we also have these religious nuts who have attached themselves to the vampires or the vampire queen, because they think this is, you know, God's take on destroying the world. So we do have that aspect, and so it's really cool watching as everyone comes together in different ways, and as Martin and Mr. work their way through these different groups to try and find the vampire queen and find safety at the same time, we get to interact and see this. What's really cool here is that, for the most part, besides a couple young female characters, they're usually grizzled old men. Now, in most movies, I would, you know, grouse on, we need more women, but who aren't used as sex objects. But in this case, actually, taking out the two women in there will probably make a stronger movie, because they do become sex objects, so it's distracting. Now, let's keep this to, you know, these grizzled people who probably would survive this Canadian vampire apocalypse, and that doesn't, yeah, or not sexualize the women, but since the women are sexualized, we have to either take it for that or move it out of the movie. So it would have been just fine with these grizzled old men, and actually pretty interesting movie if we did that. So we'd be breaking, you know, genre traditions to do that and be cool. But you know, as the writer and star, Dick Michi Lowe's and Liz Misters are Eastwood type. And then Martin is played by the same kid who played him the first time, and he's really solid. He spends most of the time, however, just kind of like staring and watching other people. This is really the old men's movie, including Stephen Williams, who genre fans will know from Jason Goes to Hell. And he, you know, he's such a interesting actor. Wish I've seen him in more. What's really awesome here is he does get the another finger breaking interrogation sequence, so yay. But that's all I really have to say about Stakeland 2. There's not a lot going on. There's just enough to keep it moving, but it's really interesting in what we're watching, and with the smaller budget, we're able to focus on a bigger working wasteland than those other times where we have like the giant compounds of Walking Dead or these giant biker gangs in other movies, where it's like, how does this still work? Instead, if you have like 12 old men shoved into a couple old buildings, yeah, that can work. That can be cool. And yeah, you know, then we have their, our Thunderdome scene, but it's all smaller than we're used to. Even smaller than like Turbo Kid, which is a great movie, which you should check out, and also listen to a podcast I was on with a good friend, Matt Ellison, the Cinema Sluts, where we talked about that before Crypticon this past year. But yeah, if you like the first Stakeland, my memories of it seem like it's be about the same. So go ahead and check that out, and I've talked about three sequel stakes, even though Tim was sure to talk about Annabelle earlier. So that's moving to no sequels tomorrow, I hope, but everything's a sequel, right? But anyway, hope you enjoyed my video. I'm a geek named Bob. Go check out ageeknamedbob.com. I promise to update that soon. Subscribe, click the bell, share. Go find me on Facebook, find me on Twitter, find everyone else on about 100 Days of Horror, and have a great day.